This is an exclusive excerpt from the Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holder.
Lee Mellor is the author of Cold North Killers, Canadian Serial Murder. It's a compilation of serial murderers from Canada. And Lee joins us on the line right now from Ontario. Hi, Lee.
Hi.
Thanks for being on the program with us. This compilation of Canadian serial killers, a lot of people don't think of serial killers when they think of Canada, but we do have our share, do we not?
Yes, that's exactly why I wrote the book. I started out where I was trying to write a fictional novel about a criminal profiler who would be working for the RCMP, and I started coming up with these fictional Canadian serial killers. Then I stopped and I realized, well, I only know about a handful of Canadian serial killers myself, and that just doesn't seem right. That doesn't add up. As much as I like to think this is, you know, a fairly peaceful country, didn't seem right. So I started to do a little research because I didn't want to repeat the killers. You know, maybe someone in fiction that had occurred in real life, I didn't want that to happen. And as I got doing the research, I realized that we had far more killers than the public is led to believe, and I ended up coming up with a number around, well, yeah, they've been going since, I stopped writing the book, so now I think we're up to at least 80.
Wow. Why do you think it is that we don't necessarily document serial killers the way other places do? Is it for fear of giving them notoriety or an attention?
That's a complex question. I think that one of the things that we have to look at is, say, compared to the United States, we do actually have much less than the United States. They have the highest rates in the world for some reason. But in the United States, you'll have programs such as Nancy Grace, where they get a lot of funding and they're very high profile. And they kind of take it to the police, where they'll make the connections themselves and the media will drill the police. You know, it seems like we have a serial killer in this situation. And if the police hear it enough, I don't think they can deny it. Whereas in Canada, we have, I think the police are a lot more reluctant to admit that we have a serial killer going on. I think there's probably more regionalism, too. For instance, there's a serial killer just emerged in Hamilton, Ontario, called Lujak Cafe. This was just recently, but I'm sure that most of Canada hasn't even heard of it.
Well, geographically speaking, where do we find, is there a pattern? Where do we find most Canadian serial killers? Is it a geographical region? Is it urban versus a rural? Is there a common denominator there in any way, shape, or form?
I would say that there are certain regions of Canada where you have greater concentrations of serial killers. Toronto, actually, for its size, doesn't have that many, but if you go a little west of Toronto around, say, London, Windsor, that area, then you start to see a greater concentration. I'm not really sure why that is. It's just one of those things. And then, of course, there's out west, British Columbia is practically ridden with them from a Canadian perspective, and a lot of that has to do with the problems with prostitution out there and the way Aboriginal women are treated by law enforcement, which is improving. Montreal has had its share as well.
It's interesting you brought up the term prostitution, and I was going to ask the question, whether it's Britain, the United States, or Canada, we often hear a link between serial killers and prostitutes.
Mm-hmm.
What is that connection, if any?
Well, the majority of serial killers are going to be heterosexual. So the majority of prostitutes are women. So if you're looking for an easy victim, a prostitute is perfect because they're willing to get into a car with you if you're a stranger. You want to drive somewhere that isolated so that you're not interrupted by the police. They'll get naked, put themselves into compromising positions, and they don't really have a lot of, I shouldn't say a blanket, but most of them don't have close ties with family as maybe the rest of us will do. So if they go missing, they're not as likely to be as immediately noticed by their family because they may have a history of being away for long periods. So there's a number of factors which play into that. Prostitutes, I would say, by far as a subgroup of women who are targeted the most, prostitutes are definitely the number one victim category in Canada. as far as my research shows.
Is there a commonality or a profile of a Canadian serial killer? Is he, I'm assuming they're mostly he, different from other people? Is he different, say, from maybe even other serial killers in other countries?
Not particularly different from serial killers in other countries. The serial killers manifest in different ways from each other. At their core, they're kind of united for the most part by fantasy. Fantasy plays a large part in the development of a serial killer. And we're talking about aberrant fantasies. When we all develop sexually growing up, I mean, we all have our certain things that we fantasize about, be you male or female, certain parts of the body, certain types of people, certain acts. The problem with a serial killer is the serial killer will tend to fantasize about things that are unhealthy or that will, so they will develop their fantasies in an unhealthy direction. So they might start off by looking at a magazine with bondage in it, which a lot of people do, you know, completely harmless. But for them, they'll need to go a little bit farther in their fantasy, and they'll start focusing maybe more on the fear on the woman's face, say if it's a detective magazine that they're focusing on. They're using this as pornography, and they're focusing on the fear on the woman's face now more than, you know, her anatomical parts. And then they start thinking, this is what I would like, and they go further and further and further. So I'd say if there's a common link between serial killers in general, it's these sort of deviant fantasies which take on a violent or dominant overtones and become kind of an integral part of them getting off sexually.
You've written this book on serial killers, Cold North Killers. You studied, if I'm not mistaken, death in school, correct?
I studied history, but I'm just a bit of a morbid person, so everything I tended to study, kind of came back to that theme. I'd studied the Penny Dreadfuls, which were these sort of cheap dime magazines printed in London and various other parts of Europe in the late 19th century, and a lot of them would focus on these kind of macabre stories, you know, Sweeney Todd, for instance, or fictionalized versions of Jack the Ripper. I guess kind of slasher movies in comic form back in the day. And so I studied them for themes for a gender class. I also did a study on the Thuggee cult in India. And that was a 19th century religious cult that they were ritualistic stranglers. Actually, if you watch the movie Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, you'll see them rather misrepresented in that. But yeah, I actually came at this from a historical background, and then I did some independent research in criminology and psychology over about a three-year period, which kind of helped.
So when you started putting this book together, Cold North Killers, did friends and family say, oh gosh, Lee's going at it again?
Actually, I was going through kind of a hard time in my life at the time, and I was having some health problems, just chronic pain. I couldn't work conventionally, and I think that a lot of them actually saw it as a healthy outlet, because it's, when you're going through hard times, it's very, for certain people, it's very difficult to be happy and, you know, focus on things that are generally viewed as more positive. So I was doing this, but it was an outlet for my personal problems at the time. It was like a catharsis, kind of saying, well, look, there's worse things out there than what I'm dealing with. And I think that my family and friends, who know me very well, they know me to be a peaceful, reasonable person. And so they didn't worry. They just, I'm a bit eccentric, you know?
Okay, well, looking at some of these serial killers, I mean, the very nature of what they do is they kill in a serialistic kind of way. They kill over a period of time. What is it about these guys that make them successful for as long as they are? Because they have to be able to get away with it for a period of time to rack up the body counts.
Yeah, and the funny thing is you'd think it would be intelligence. But really, some of the most successful serial killers have been measured to have the lowest IQ. For instance, Robert Picton, who is one of our more prolific serial killers, he's probably killed between 31 and 49 women, if not more. He's been convicted of six. He has been measured as having an 87 IQ, which is not very bright. Whereas you get people like Paul Bernardo or Russell Williams, and they've been measured as having quite high IQs, I believe like in the 120s, 130s, and they've killed two people in Williams' cases, three that we know of in Bernardo. So it's certainly not linked to intelligence. I think what it comes down to mostly is there's luck, there's the competency of the police forces who are investigating, and there's also probably the biggest factor, who you were selecting to kill. Let's look at who Robert Picton killed. He killed drug-addicted prostitutes who he picked up on Maine and Hastings and took out to his farm. Who did Paul Bernardo and Russell Williams kill? They killed middle-class women. And so their cases became more of a priority for Canadian police departments, and the public fixated on them a bit more.
It's an interesting study indeed, looking at the various serial murderers in Canadian history. The book is called Cold North Killers, Canadian Serial Murder. It's written by Lee Meller. And Lee, I thank you very, very much for taking the time to be on the program with us.
Oh, thank you. I hope that I was of some use in understanding these monsters.
And we want to mention very quickly, you're going to be in Montreal and in Kingston for book signings, correct?
Yes, I'll be in Montreal on March the 10th. That's Saturday. I'll be at the Chapters downtown, Centerville, by Peel and St. Catherine. I'll be there from about 2 to 5. Feel free to introduce yourself. I'm a pretty affable guy. And Kingston, it's March the 24th, also a Saturday. I'm on the Chapters on Princess Street, and that will be 2 to 5 as well. And if you have Toronto listeners, next Saturday I'm at a bookshop called Nicholas Hoare on Front Street, 45 Front Street East. I'll be there from 1 to 4 signing the book as well.
Thank you very much, Lee.
Okay, thank you, Peter.
Lee Meller is the author of Cold North Killers, Canadian Serial Murder. You can go to my website at thestufffile.com, go to the What's On page for this show, which is show number 0133, and you'll find links to Lee's website, plus links to either Amazon.com or Amazon.ca, where you can order the book directly.
You've just heard an exclusive excerpt from the Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holder. To hear any or all of the full hour-long shows, visit thestufffile.com. Stuff is spelled S-T-U-P-H. That's thestufffile.com. A presentation of Flying Fish Communications.